I will try to wake you up. Any of you have gone through the Ministry of Power website recently? How many?
Never.
None. You go through it. They have changed the website. And on that website, there is a PowerPoint presentation. 27 slides are there, talking about 200 successful days of the new government. I have chosen 6 slides, although I can't show it to you, but I will read it out for you what it is. They can see it. Okay, I'll read it out. The one of the slides, slide number 2, says 28 crores in around 5. You can't project? And forget about that, doctor. If they can show it to me, they can show my iPad also.
Yeah, yeah.
But
we can see it.
Yeah, okay.
Yes, yes. This time.
This slide. Correct. So what it is showing, 28 crores in around 5.6 crore families with no access to electricity, even after 67 years of independence. This is half of the slide. Second part of the slide, that is the red color, it says load shedding and power cuts are still a norm in many states. That's the Ministry of Power is saying. Affecting, what it is affecting? Education of the youth, jobs and industrial production, and critical health care infrastructure is getting affected in this country today. This is another slide. This slide says electricity suppliers lose rupees 70,000 crores every year. This slide is saying that, and have huge losses of 250,000 crores of rupees. This is a statement. And other part is showing this part. Common man has to pay high tariff because of power theft and financial and technical losses. This is also the statement. And this has come only maybe 2-3 weeks back only. 200 days have passed only about few days back. The next slide says, coal and gas supply is not enough to power the plants. On the other hand, people don't get power from the several power plants are stranded. Huge unharnessed renewable energy. They are talking about solar and wind. It says small-scale developers of solar, hydel and biomass are stuck with thousands crores of rupees subsidy from the government. Unpaid subsidy, it has not been paid. Mere 2700 megawatts of solar power out of 3 lakh megawatt potential has been harnessed. Similarly, 21,000 megawatts of 102,000 megawatts potential of wind power has been harnessed. I will not go much more on this, but I'm trying to tell you that what the ministry is trying to tell, that for one of the slides is ensure grid security. Amendment to Electricity Act under approval of Parliament to tighten grid security to avert 2012-like collapse, that there was a collapse in northern India in 2012 July. Spinning reserve being created. 8,600 crores are being spent for protection system for safety and security of the grid. They are saying pay less for power. They are talking of producing more coal, crushing it at the mine head and bringing crushed coal to the power plant and reduce the transportation cost, carriage of fly ash, etc.
Dr. Deo, are you sure this is the Ministry of Power website or somebody's hacked it and put all this in? This is ridiculous.
This is what it is showing, being shown there.
I'm a little surprised that they have tied up the 2012 collapse with spinning reserve, because one of the reasons why the grid collapsed was one of that, I think that Agra Gwalior line was not in operation, and the other line was not, got overloaded because some of the thermal stations were not backing down. Because otherwise they would have become uneconomical. So I don't know how spinning reserve.
We are not discussing what happened in July 2012. We are only saying this is what the ministry is putting it on the website with reference to the amendment to the Electricity Act. From that angle only I am showing some of the things. then there is one more slide, very important. Inconvenient truth and convenient action. So I will not trouble you with the details. At your spare time, go to the Ministry of Power website.
Please read this one. Inconvenient truth and convenient action.
Compulsory crushing and washing of coal and reduce ash transport by linking plants of to their closest mines. Plans to increase afforestation. Initiated studies to work on a national plan to make river flow potential if hydropower project is established. Zero effect development and saving the environment. Massive thrust on renewable to increase the share of clean energy in India's energy mix. Then there are something about Grameen area, that is chulas and other things. So I have finished those six slides. I will proceed for my talk to you, not presentation. I have been in this sector for more than 25 years, power part. I am not electrical engineer. I find, after working closely with this sector, there is a lack of collective knowledge about this sector, and particularly the scheme. What is the scheme under which we are proposing what we have proposed? So there are some Sanskrit or Marathi words, you may call it sankalpa, siddhi and prayatna. You make a sankalpa to achieve some siddhi, and to achieve that you have to make some prayatna, that means efforts. A decision you have to take that this is what I want to achieve. What is that exactly I'm going to achieve, in what steps, in what efforts I'm going to take? That is sankalpa, siddhi and prayatna combination. And this is exactly not coming in the power sector. I will take you to the changing dynamics of power sector for the last 100 years. Electricity has come to India only about 100 years back. In 1910, we were issuing licenses to private players. They established their power plants in the city and served the community around 5-10 kilometers radius. We had more than 100 licenses in Maharashtra alone. Pune Electric Supply Company, Viraj Electric Supply Company, Thane Electric Supply Companies, all private. They were producing, they were transmitting or distributing and going to each house, collecting their bills. Everything was moving very fine. What happened? 1948 Supply Act came. Now this Supply Act came after independence, and this act was based on the UK Supply Act of 1927. The purpose of that UK Supply Act was to reconstruct UK after devastation from the First World War. So there was more of humanitarian methods, more of social functions there, and that is how that act was there. That act came here. We said in India that in 1948 we will have state grid. Instead of producing power at various places, they will continue to do the supply business, but we'll develop a grid. And instead of doing the grid work, they have done some grid work, but they have also nationalized all 100 plus licenses in Maharashtra. This has happened in all other states also. So today's distribution company is nothing but whatever was there in 1910 Act, those private players. Some of the claims are still in high courts. The claims have not been paid by MSEB so far. They are in high court. Now, when the requirement went up, the government money was not adequate, and we had to put our 50 tons of gold mortgage in London. At that time, IMF gave $690 million tranche, and they said, you open up your power sector. That was the condition. So we brought this modification to the Supply Act, IPP, Independent Power Producers. This is after this association came in the being actually. Independent Power Producers Association, after this. You know, with IPP, Enron came, number of American companies came, they went. They taught something to our Indians. We lost some money in that education. And that particular amendment or whatever tweaking we had done to our Supply Act failed, miserably failed. We did not get any power. We lost money in the process. So our country thought, okay, what is the way out? Without knowing what is there in the power sector. So fortunately, the ministers and others, they thought over it. and Electricity Act 2003 was born. There were 12 drafts for that act. It took more than 3 years to go through clause by various sectors of the country, and then this act was passed. Now we are in 2015, 14, they thought, in 14 they thought, oh, 2003 act has not worked. It is not delivering what it is supposed to deliver. What it was supposed to deliver? The act was supposed to deliver that power will be produced by the society and sold by society at competitive prices. Government has no business to be in the business of power sector. That is what the act is saying. So market forces, competition, you produce your de-license the generation, produce your power anywhere in the country, pay the toll charges and bring your power to your premises. That was the concept. Sell half of the power so that it becomes economical for you. What has happened? No, nothing has come. Why it has not come? Most important question. There is a provision in the act that the competition, there are, this word competition has come at several places in the act. You go through the annual reports of several regulatory commissions, including MERC. Nowhere they are given any single line or even the word of competition is missing from their annual reports. Go through Northern India, Southern India, nowhere. The commission never felt that it is their job to bring competition. In fact, the commission was formed basically to take this power sector from monopoly to market under their guidance. They have failed, miserably failed. And not only they have failed, there is a provision in the act, in order to have competition, the economic treatise says, in order to have competition and the market, you cannot have administered or regulated prices. And this is what we have seen in case of diesel and petrol. Now, this act was also knowing that, and this act under section 86(1)(a) proviso said, when we give choice of supplier, particularly to this 1 megawatt and above consumers within 5 years' time, then their tariff will not be determined by the regulatory commission. They will only determine the billing charges and cross-subsidy surcharge, if any. Our regulators continue to draw the tariff for all the consumers, including 1 megawatt. They are flouting the law. They have taken oath that they will be loyal to the constitution, they will be loyal to this particular act, and they will implement. They have failed to implement. Not only they have failed to implement, many people have not understood. At this juncture, I will tell you one story. After leaving MERC, where I have contributed in making Electricity Act 2003, I found that unless there is a market, there cannot be open access, there cannot, nobody will bring private power, selling it to whom? It is instantly perishable commodity. So I started working on the power exchange model. Finally, after 3 years of working, regulatory commission, government accepted, and they allowed Indian Energy Exchange to be the first exchange in the country to operate. I became first MD CEO of that exchange. It was in June 2008 it started. I was going through the act as to what are the supports which are going to come for the exchange. And I landed on this clause 86(1)(a) proviso, which says there will not be tariff determined. So I took this paper and started talking to several people in the sector. First, I went to the number one man who was the power secretary in the year 2003, Mr. R.V. Shahi. He flatly refused. He said, no, it was not our intention. There has to be tariff. After talking to him for 3 hours, he said, yes, the meaning of this sentence and this particular clause is like that, but that was not our intention. Then I went to Mr. Alok Kumar, another IAS officer, who was director in the ministry when the act was passed, and he has drafted the act. And in 2008, he was a secretary to CERC. After discussing with him, he said, no, this is wrong. You have got wrong impression. This is not possible. The point is, the person who is at the highest place, the person who has drafted the act, and not very simple person, IAS officer, with almost 25, 30 years experience, they have drafted this act and they don't know what is this animal they have created. So the act says competition, transparency and all that, but the makers do not know that this is there. So eventually, I landed in planning commission. And I explained to them that this is the proviso. If it is implemented, then the competition will come. Planning commission took on themselves. They went to Ministry of Law and Justice. And after 1.5 years of efforts, Law and Justice Ministry said, yes, this is correct. And they gave their opinion, which was given to Power Ministry. And Power Ministry wrote to all the stakeholders in the country, including MERC, that you stop taking the tariff for these consumers. And further details, no action was taken by any of the... See, Hari Dhawal has said in the morning today, that paper was taken to that for Hydel Power. And he said, I don't recognize this paper. Similarly, our regulators also behaved like that. And they said, we don't recognize. Who is Power Ministry to tell us? We are the judges. We know what is the law. We will go by our own methods. And they have not done that. And one by one, at least a couple of regulators, regulatory commissions, have gone through the ordeal of this public debate on this. Meaning of the law, they are asking public through public debate. And they said, no. And what is the excuse? They say, cross-subsidy surcharge, kaisa nikalega hum iske upar? The policy simply says that cross-subsidy surcharge is to be worked out and reduced to 20% of average cost of supply. Once it is given there, then every time average cost of supply you are working out for retail consumers. No, they are not accepting that. The Act recognizes a market which consists of wholesale, bulk and retail. The regulatory commissions have power to fix the tariff for only retail consumers. This 86(1)(a) proviso takes out some of the retail consumers who are having more than 1 megawatt load or one megawatt plus contract demand as bulk consumers. So bulk consumers tariff they cannot determine. They continue. And in the process, what's happening? They are doing injustice to retail consumers. Today morning, you have heard Dr. Dev, Ajay Mehta's, that 60%.
I want to ask you a question.
Yeah.
If the under 86(1)(a), they cannot determine the tariff, but when this particular consumer goes for open access, cross-subsidy surcharge is leviable?
Yeah, cross-subsidy surcharge, that proviso, if you read, it says that there will be wheeling charges and cross-subsidy surcharge, if any. And the policy says cross-subsidy surcharge has to come down and come to a level of 20% of average cost of supply by the year 2011 and 12. So putting these three things together, you can work out tariff.
And also temporary charge.
Temporary charge. Secondly, they say there is a universal service obligation. So why 1 megawatt consumer universal service obligation? Now the Electricity Act has been amended in 2007, couple of amendments, and which added under section 43, four or five words. Notwithstanding anything contained in this act, comma, the distribution license will give supply. So that means supply to retail consumers. For all other consumers, universal service obligation is only giving connection. And that is what the APTEL in their judgment of 2008-2009 period, they have said that yes, giving connection is the universal service obligation. Giving supply is not universal service obligation. Unfortunately, our regulators still are not interested in doing that job. They are working against the country's interest. And that's why this kind of amendments in terms of their selection, their tenure, if this amendment are passed, more than half of the present day regulators will go home in less than 1 year's time. And not only that, they will have to face the performance appraisal performance review. Are you aware of this? There is a provision. No, I'm not on that. I'm only on what has happened so far. Now, we have not done the implementation of the act properly, and for that, a basic weakness lies with our regulator. Now, within that, without knowing what has gone wrong, how it can be corrected, what we are supposed to achieve, what was our sankalpa, what is our sadhya, we started with this amendment. 12 years have passed after passing that act. Half the generation. Normally, one generation works for 25 years. 12 years have passed. Nothing has come out of this. And there is a phrase in Marathi, iza viza tiza. We failed Enron and IPP. We have failed 2003 Act, and now we are going for this. If at all this is passed, this is also going to fail if we do not understand what this animal is about and what is the pilot, how do we proceed about it. I'm going to talk about how do we proceed about it. Visa, visa, visa. If it happens once, it happens twice. Right. It is
I heard
to
visa, visa,
time.
Visa.
Visa, visa, visa.
My mind is somewhere else.
So what we are talking here in terms of amendment to the Act is basically nothing but symptomatic treatment. If you don't know what is wrong with the patient and you start only treating his headache or you start treating his ache somewhere or some lack of appetite and all that, patient is never going to get cleaned, cleared, so far the health part is concerned. He will only spend money. So my fear is in another 10 years will pass, in 2025 they will say, sorry, this also doesn't work. This is what several speakers have said since morning. Unless we take certain precautions, it will not work.
We'll book the hall now itself. For the, we'll book this hall for that 2025.
And 2025 they will say, SEB model was the best, so bring SEB model back. Fortunately, he has said that SEB model in the dormant format is kept ready, you know. No financial powers given to different companies. So please remember that we are heading for SEB model in 2020 or 2025, depending on the failure rate of this particular amendment, if at all they are passed. They can be passed, this is good. But before that, we must walk few steps. Within the existing Act, we can walk that. What is it? Competition. Basically, we are talking of competition, basically. Now, today, we are supplying power to industry and business community who are producing goods and services in a competitive environment and selling it in competitive environment. They are bringing their inputs, maybe 50 or 100 inputs, in the competitive market and sell their goods services in competition. So at least this category of consumers in the whole country can be given power which is whose price is determined competitively. So you take out 40% of the total power consumption in the country, bring it on some kind of exchange or some kind of platform, determine daily the price there for every 15 minutes and sell that power to these groups. If you want, you can protect some small business and commercial consumers of say up to 10 kilowatt. This can be done, and it can be done immediately without tweaking anything in the Act. It is there in the Act. We are supposed to give open access to all the consumers. Let us give open access to all the business and industrial consumers, irrespective of their quantum of load. And whatever the excess power which distribution company has PPA'd, that means created a contract for buying that power, they can sell that power on the exchange. Because they themselves cannot make a contract for selling this power because they cannot determine the rate and they are afraid of CVC, Vigilance Commission. So, okay, let us go to the market, sell our excess power, buy from that power. They can buy same power and sell it by adding 2-3 paisa as their margin to all these consumers. So every day there will be a different price for these consumers. And that is how we can proceed. We can start in 6 months' time. This can be done. I am a person of delivery. I have delivered MERC, I have delivered power exchange. If required, I can deliver this type also of giving competitive power to this group of consumers. If we do that, we'll gain some experience in 1 year's time, 2 years' time. And then we can think of this separating wire business, separating carrier and container, and several other things we can do it. But first, a pilot, and the pilot I propose for the competitive power. Now, going outside India, how other countries have faced this? I'll give three examples. Singapore, anybody needing more than 10,000 kilowatt hours of power every month has to buy power at the market rate from the market or through these traders. You go to Spain. In Spain, anybody having connection of more than 10 kilowatt has to buy power at market rates. He is not protected. Now you will say you are told about advanced city-state of Singapore, you talked about the European country of Spain. I'll talk of African country, Ghana, which is far lower compared to the developmental aspect of India. Their power requirement is only 1% of what India needs. They also have gone for competitive power market for 3 megawatt and above consumers 4 years back. And they were laughing when the delegation came to Bombay, India. In Delhi, they met us in exchange, and they said, you are far behind us. We are far ahead. And today morning, you have heard Mr. Dev, Dr. Dev, you have heard, you have also heard others. Basic issue is with our regulators. Basic issue is that if we stop determining the tariff, there will be market. All the people who are coming, today what's happening, exchange is selling power at 2.50 rupees. But utilities are dispatching 4.50 rupees power, 5 rupees power, but not buying 2.50 rupees power. They are doing injustice to the country. They are doing injustice to these consumers. It's high time our regulators should accept this. 1 megawatt and above, they will not take out the tariff. Or else, we ask that, okay, this part of amendment, so far the regulators are concerned, implement it immediately. Half the regulators will go home. Remaining half, they don't perform, they will also go home, and we will have proper market in this country. Thank you so much.
Dr. Deo, I have a question for you before. When you bolo to hai, but tumhi tikde jao na. Question is, you said something about CVC. I was half asleep, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
In the middle of my cup of tea. What has CVC got to do with power exchange, number one? Number two, in the sense, these state distribution companies are basically intrastate licenses, right? Somebody came up with this in the Delhi conference, that's why I'm asking you, since you have run the exchange.
Yeah.
The intrastate, let us say MSEDCL or anybody else, has an intrastate license, he can trade power within the state.
Yeah.
But the power exchange transaction happens on the region. How does he cross the state boundary without a license and do interstate trade? Please tell me.
Okay. Two things. My reference to CVC was under Section 49 in today's Act, the utilities are allowed to make a contract with any consumer, open access consumer, and fix a tariff for him. Now, what happens, you know, any contract, any kind of thing, even if there is a genuine contract, genuine understanding of his load factor, power factor, etc., still there is a doubt hanging on his head. Other day, that ONGC director was sacked because he has done some irregularities. So that kind of fear is there in the public sector undertakings, and that's why they don't stick out their neck in making this kind of contract. So therefore, what I'm saying that since they can't do this kind of contract arising out of fear of Vigilance Commission and all that, they can sell their power on the exchange, and exchange power is accepted by everybody in the country that this is a transparent manner of price discovery. And whatever 2-3 paisa is the margin which is allowed to a trading community, that margin they can charge and supply that power to the existing consumers. So consumer doesn't have to go for ABT tariff or anything. Only thing, he will pay a tariff which is not determined by the commission, but it is determined by the market forces. This is what our amended act is also saying. What is the second part of your question? Interstate?
Interstate licensees selling on interstate to the exchange.
No difficulty, because they will be say on the exchange what happens. You can bid whatever price you want. The demand supply curves are drawn. And wherever they are meeting, that is the price for all the suppliers and that is the price for all the buyers.
I'm not on price. Huh. Intrastate trader, distribution company, is giving the power or buying the power in the region, not in the state.
Yeah.
His license stops him from the beyond the state border, because he's intrastate trader. How does he do that?
No, they are deemed trading licenses, actually. They are deemed trading licenses, so there is
They're deemed trading license intrastate, no?
No, not intrastate.
Determined on the state tariff.
We're not about price. We're talking about trading itself. They are deemed intrastate trading licenses, not deemed as interstate trading licenses. Am I right?
No. The distribution companies are interstate trading licenses. All over India, they have got jurisdiction. I'm talking of distribution companies, licensed distribution companies. No, this is not my understanding. Otherwise, cheaper power from other states will not come to our state. There is no stop anywhere. And in fact, for whatever wrong understanding or right understanding, most of the utilities are drawing PPA power, even if it is 4 rupees 50 paisa, though there is another supplier who is prepared to give you at 2 rupees 50 paisa. They're not buying that.
So what you're saying is that an intrastate trader is actually an interstate trader, a distribution company.
No, intrastate trader is different. I am talking of your distribution
company. Distribution company.
Distribution company is a deemed trading licensee for the whole country. Because after open access, 1 megawatt and above consumers come in the market, the same distribution company can sell his power to all 1 megawatt and above consumers across the country. And that's why he can't be limited only within his state. If you want to ask otherwise, I have one more point.
I will read out the provision that is under section 14, grant of license. The appropriate commission may, on an application made it to under section 15, grant a license to any person to transmit electricity as a transmission licensee or to distribute electricity as a distribution licensee or to undertake trading in electricity as an electricity trader in any area as may be specified in the licensee.
So Tata area, as per Supreme Court, is specified in Mumbai. He can't go outside Mumbai for trading.
For trading.
No bar. That's the point. Yeah. One more thing I wanted to share with you, since this question has brought it to my mind. See, you have seen in 1910 we were limited to the city. After 48, we have gone to state. After 2008 exchange came, we have gone to the country. For optimizing our power resources, we have gone to the country. And with our dialogue with Nepal, Bhutan, Bangladesh, and also Pakistan now, we are interchanging power with the neighboring countries. And at that time only, when the exchange was started, I said, look, we are going to become SARC exchange. And in another 5 to 10 years time, we'll become Asian exchange. Because they find that bigger the region, better is the resource utilization of electricity and energy. So this is happening all over, even the Middle East, this is happening, this is happening in Africa, already happening in Canada and US, it's happening in several other parts of the world. So this will come to India also. In such a situation, our regulations and our freedom to go out and do the trading, etc., has to be more liberal and not constrictive. There should not be any constraint on that. This is the need of the hour, that we go and work our energy across the country, further in the region. Even after a few days, Myanmar also will join our exchange. Exchange in the sense, the exchange of electricity between Myanmar and India. So from that angle, our viewpoint should be that yes, bigger, and not restricting ourselves to only MSEDCL.
Thank you, sir.